Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming today. This is actually the sixth of our colloquia series for this year at the Jack Joseph and Morton Mandel School of Applied Social Sciences. I'm Elizabeth Tracy. I'm a professor, and I'm the Associate Dean for Research and Training. And as you know, this colloquia series is sponsored by the Office of Research Administration and the doctoral program at the school. We have one more colloquia after this in March. So you'll look for that to be coming. A few logistics. Most of you know that the restrooms are down the hall. Make sure to pick up your CEU certificates if you signed up for CEUs. And for faculty and doctoral students who are getting continuing research education credits, make sure you sign that list, because then that list goes over to the Office of Research Administration and your credits will appear online for you. Some thank yous to Ina Brand and Carm Gambatese, who you saw when you signed in, and to Tracy Braddon, who has helped with all the arrangements. And we have Abby Asmus, who is on the computer for us today. She's the person that, if you are connecting remotely, she's the person that you would send a question to, and she would let the speakers know that you had a question. If you have a question and you're online, you would email mandelschool@case.edu. And as you know, because we're recording in here, when you have a question, please wait until Lee runs over to you with the microphone so that the people remotely can hear the question as well. The theme this year for our centennial colloquia series was featuring our own cutting-edge research at the school. And so today's topic is navigating HIPAA, FERPA, and IRB. It's presented by Dr. Elizabeth Anthony, who's a research assistant professor at the school, and Dr. Rob Fischer, who's a research professor and the co-director of the Center on Poverty and Community Development. He actually spoke a month ago, so we're putting him on an every other month retainer from now on. And at 2 p.m., if you have questions, we have room 114 reserved, so if you wanted to talk more with Beth and Rob, you could at that time. But at this point, join me in welcoming Dr. Anthony, who will start the presentation.
Hi, everyone.
Hello.
Thanks for coming. And thank you for the opportunity, Betsy, to speak about this topic and research. I know I learned a lot putting this together. I hope you do too as well. I want to dispel or just sort of disappoint you all to begin with. Rob and I are not experts in HIPAA or FERPA, but we have learned a lot in using integrated data at the Poverty Center, and we've successfully been able to navigate HIPAA and FERPA to gain access to identifiable data that is governed by these regulations. So what we'd like to share with you today are some of the lessons that we've learned, the successes that we've had, and hear from you all if you've had any experience as well. So that's what we're planning. Before we get into the topic, I want to acknowledge that this is truly a team effort, and none of this could be done without the amazing faculty, students, and staff of the Poverty Center, who I hope I didn't miss anyone. If you are at the Poverty Center, and I did, please raise your hand so we can acknowledge you. I apologize for that. But really, I feel like a mouthpiece today that I get to share this research, but it took everyone up here to produce what we're going to be talking about. All right, we have four goals for today. We would like to talk about the role of integrated data in research. Some of that integrated data might fall under this umbrella of big data. Some of it may not. As I said, we're going to address the role of specifically HIPAA and FERPA. These are federal privacy regulations that may govern some of the data that you might want to gain access to. We'll talk about two specific examples, one using HIPAA-regulated data, the other using FERPA-regulated data, and some ongoing work that we're involved in at our center. And lastly, we're going to open it up for questions and comments. So this slide presents a visual of some of the many systems at work in human development. It's just some. There are so many more that we could have put on here. And many of these systems provide data to us at our center, which we're going to be talking about later. But I wanted to illustrate this to represent two different points that we'll be coming back to throughout the talk. One is that, you know, throughout the course of human development, children and families are involved in multiple systems that are all designed to help improve their well-being and a variety of outcomes. And at any one point in time, children and families can be involved in multiple systems. So you could take a cross section at any one point in time and see overlap in the systems that are serving one specific child or family. On the other hand, you can look longitudinally, and you can see that the work for the systems that come later in human development really depend upon the work that's already been done by some of the systems earlier on. And what's interesting here is if you think about systems earlier on in this trajectory, oftentimes they're working to prevent an outcome that won't be realized until later on in the course of development. So in one sense, the outcomes of their efforts require some sort of cross-system collaboration to see if it ever does materialize or not. All of these systems regularly produce administrative records, and these are typically used internally. That might be just to monitor their operations, to write up some sort of annual report about how many clients and families have been served, and then more and more often to obtain grant funding. You have to be able to document that what you're doing with the money you're getting is producing positive impact. So those administrative records already exist. At the same time, there's this notion of collective impact, which is really, don't want to offend, but probably collaboration, just by another fancy term. The idea is that no single organization is responsible for any major social problem, nor can any single organization cure it. It takes large-scale social change from cross-sector coordination rather than the isolated interventions of any one organization. So we know the data exists. There's a framework now via this collective impact model to work toward integrating these data. So the collective impact model is a little bit unique in that it does sort of outline the idea of a backbone organization that is going to organize all of these systems in play around a common agenda, shared measurement, shared outcome variables. So that's the new addition with this collective impact notion. So we have these two things. We have so much data available to us, and we have the technology now and the infrastructure to begin to analyze it. So Dennis Culhane, he's a professor at the University of Pennsylvania. He's very involved in the integrated data movement. He's also involved with the Actionable Intelligence for Social Policy initiative, and he dubs the integration of administrative data across service agencies as the next frontier for generating quality evidence. And the idea is that these pieces of information exist. We can harness them to drive informed decision making and policy change. So we've thrown around the term integrated data for a while. Finally, I'm going to define it. What we're talking about are linked individual level records. So these are identifiable pieces of information that are produced by all those systems I showed you a few slides ago, these administrative agencies. So these could be school districts, child welfare agencies, juvenile justice organizations, after school alliances, Boys and Girls Club, not necessarily the negative side of things. These could also be volunteerism, employment opportunities that children are becoming involved in. So we are no longer stuck within our data silos. We have the capability and we have the technology to integrate our data. So the federal government was, we'll see what happens now, very interested in the notion of integrating administrative data, big data. In 2010 to 2014, there was a series of memos that the Office of Management and Budget issued, and this was really encouraging the use of big data, integrated data, and providing a lot of guidance on how to do it. So how can you harness these data sets to drive informed decision making? The 2016 federal budget included a significant portion on opening up access to all the data systems held by the federal government. And in 2016, Congress also established the Commission on Evidence-Based Policy. So the goal with this commission is really to determine how can we use the data that exists and integrate them, make them accessible to the general public for evaluation, learning, policy change, but do so while managing individual privacy, right? Because these are protected pieces of information held within there. I'm going to come back to that notion in a little bit, this idea of managing privacy while opening up access. So this slide highlights just some of the many challenges to research. These are not necessarily unique to integrated data, so research using integrated data, right? I mean, nearly all research that we conduct here at the Mandel School is going to be subject to the Common Rule and IRB approval. And I'm going to go through the Common Rule, Privacy Act, HIPAA, and FERPA regulations in more detail. Rob will talk a little bit about some of the scientific challenges, and we have just a beginning discussion of the ethical ramifications of this kind of work. But that is sort of, in my opinion, a lagging behind conversation. So the technology has really taken off, but people are scrambling behind to think about the ethical ramifications. So like I said, these are not necessarily challenges that are unique to integrated data, but the use of integrated data may ramp them up a bit, right? They may be a little bit more prominent because of the nature of the information contained. So the Common Rule of 1991, I start here even though the Privacy Act came first, but I wanted to establish the definition of research that we're going to be working with. And I feel like at all of these coming slides, they're sort of like an off-ramp, right? So if you don't meet the definition, you don't have to worry about these things, right? You probably have a whole set of other things to worry about, but not these things. So the first idea is that we have to be actually conducting research, which according to Health and Human Services is a systematic investigation, and the purpose of which is to contribute to generalizable knowledge. Okay, so if you think your body of work falls within that definition, then it's subject to the Common Rule. So it was called the Common Rule because 15 or so federal agencies signed on to abide by it. Health and Human Services is one of them, so a lot of the research that we do would be subject to the Common Rule. And what it did is really outline the basic framework for ethics and regulation of research using human subjects. It's important to us because it established the IRB assurance and the need for IRB approval and monitoring of our research. And the basic consent requirement among the IRB, right, is that most often we're going to need documented informed consent. However, here's our first exception. So the IRB can waive documented informed consent if you can meet these three requirements. So if you can show or, you know, demonstrate to the IRB that your research is involving no more than minimal risk, that the waiver is not going to adversely affect the rights of your participants, and that you couldn't actually really do the research without the waiver, you could be granted a waiver of informed consent from the IRB. So lots of people have probably already done this and gotten a waiver. How many people have experienced requesting a waiver of informed consent? Okay, not as many as I thought. But this is probably what you're most familiar with, and then there are exceptions to these other regulations that we're going to talk about now. So the Privacy Act, this came first, 1974. This is the basic regulation of personally identifiable information that's held by the federal government. Personally identifiable information is these 18 different things. I have the whole list if you want it, but I won't bore you with that. It's what you would expect, right? Name, date of birth, social security number, address, home address. But it's also things like a URL. I was surprised by fax number. Fax number is one that might be phased out one day. So there are 18 pieces of information that are considered personally identifiable. So if your research is going to use any of those, it would be subject to the Privacy Act. Again, the Privacy Act would require you to get the informed consent of any participant unless your research falls within one of 12 exceptions. And the one that's applicable for research is routine use. So there's a whole definition of what routine use means. I thought I'd spare you and just tell you that's where the research exception fits. So if you can make the case that you fall under there, this notion of needing documented informed consent could be waived for your study. If I guess I should just also say, if there are questions, I'd be happy to take a couple as we go, but we have left time at the end. So if things come up and you want to sort of just jot down a note, it might be easier since we need to pass the mic around. All right, HIPAA, 1996. So basically, HIPAA is going to govern protected health information that is held by covered entities. We'll talk about that, what that means in just a second, because that took a while to figure out. But again, like the Privacy Act, there are 12 different exceptions to HIPAA. So instead of getting a HIPAA authorization from each individual that you're interested in accessing their data, you can apply for a waiver of HIPAA authorization. So research is one of the 12 exceptions, and to be able to get the waiver of HIPAA authorization, you have to get a letter from the IRB at your institution. And that letter has to say a lot of different things. There's a whole list of exactly what that letter has to contain. But the three things that are really, really important are what we sort of already talked about. The IRB has to be able to say that that protected health information is going to involve no more than minimal risk to the participant's privacy, that you probably couldn't actually do the research without the waiver, and that you couldn't do the research without the protected health information. So here's another off-ramp to HIPAA. If you want to use de-identified data, you don't have to go through this process. You could also use what's known as a limited data set, which actually does provide some of those 18 pieces of identifiable information, but in a less complete form. So again, other ways to use data that is governed by HIPAA, but not necessarily go through this process. With integrated data, we need all those identifiable pieces of information to link across agencies. We don't need facts, but we need like date of birth and name, social security number we don't usually use, but that's one of those pieces of information that is obviously very private. So as I said, you have to figure out, one, if you're using protected health information, and two, if it's held by a covered entity. So not all health information is protected health information. Protected health information is identifiable information. It includes demographics, but it's specifically related to any past, present, or future diagnoses or conditions, past, present, or future services, treatment receipt, and any past, present, or future payment of those services. So figuring out if what you want really falls within there is something you can do with this easy-to-use 58-page decision tree that federal government has provided. So if you're looking for something to do tonight, it's super challenging to try to figure it out and navigate. So there are a lot of things out there, but it does take a lot of time to really figure out if you're working with protected health information and if it's held by a covered entity. So the thing about us here at CASE is we're a hybrid entity because we have covered entities like the medical school and the dental school, and then we have departments like MSAS. These are not covered entities. We're considered a hybrid. The Ohio Health Department, that's a hybrid entity. The health department operates like every arm of the health department, though, is a covered entity. So what you have to figure out, it's not really about us here at CASE. It's about the provider that holds the data that you want access to. Sometimes they will ask what CASE is because they may feel more or less comfortable with sharing if you are also a covered entity. But it's really about identifying what is that agency that holds the protected health information that you want. So a covered entity, there are three kinds. Healthcare provider that transmits records electronically. So I don't know of any providers that don't these days. So I'm just saying it's a healthcare provider. Could also be a healthcare clearinghouse, which we have an example of that in a second, or a healthcare plan, Medicaid, managed care plans. Those three categories are covered entities. I find the clearinghouse to be most confusing, and so the example that we have actually uses a clearinghouse. So again, there's some help if you want it. There you go. Okay. So we had experience actually requesting a waiver of HIPAA authorization, and this was for a project that's funded by the Offices of Early Childhood Invest in Children, which is a Cuyahoga County public-private partnership that's working to improve the health and school readiness of children 0 to 6. They fund, in part, early childhood mental health services that are delivered throughout Cuyahoga County by one of several behavioral health agencies. Those behavioral health agencies, I feel like we need a map, right? Those behavioral health agencies submit their data to the Adams Board of Cuyahoga County. And I can't tell you what that stands for. Yes, I can. Alcohol, Drug Addiction, and Mental Health Services of Cuyahoga County. Okay. So they send their data over to the Adams Board. And the Adams Board, in my opinion, but I would really have to check, is, I think, an example of a healthcare clearinghouse, one of these warehouses. So they're responsible for planning, funding, and monitoring mental health and addiction treatment services to Cuyahoga County residents. They hold the identifiable health information regarding the mental health services delivered by these community agencies. So we wanted that identifiable data from the Adams Board so that we could conduct an evaluation of early childhood mental health services. And one of their attorneys was very hesitant to give us access to that protected health information. So what we were able to do is work with the IRB, who were able to create one of these letters that had all the requirements that the waiver of HIPAA requires, and also were able to put those three things on it, that the access to the PHI wasn't going to necessarily involve more than minimal risk, we couldn't do the research without a waiver, and we couldn't do the research without the protected health information. When our IRB gave us that, we gave it to the Adams Board, and then they gave us the data. But the whole process highlights that organizations, covered entities, or educational institutions, when we get to FERPA, these bodies are not mandated to share this type of information, and that's where the relationship comes into play. It's permissible. There are exceptions to these regulations, but just because you get a waiver of HIPAA authorization doesn't necessarily mean they're going to hand over their protected health information. So the relationship is key, and Rob will be talking about that in regard to the FERPA regulations. All right, so that was it on HIPAA. I'm going to turn now to FERPA. FERPA, federal regulation that governs student records that are held by educational institutions that receive funding from the Department of Education. So a lot of charter schools, not all, and a lot of private schools aren't necessarily subject to FERPA regulation because they might, you know, they don't accept DOE funds. So unlike HIPAA that had one exception for research, FERPA has three. There's the audit and evaluation exception, the school official, and the studies. And you could make the case, depending on your research question, you know, which one of these exceptions fits. So the audit and evaluation is really if you have some sort of interest in evaluating a program of the educational institution. You have to become an authorized representative of that educational setting, and you can imagine there's a 58-page tool to tell you how to do that and what that means, but that is the exception. The school official exception, this is for outside entities that have what's known as a legitimate educational interest in the personally identifiable information that's held by the educational institution. And the key here is that the outside entity is going to perform an organization that school officials and employees would perform if not for this outside entity. The last one is the studies exception, and you can gain access to protected personally identifiable information if you're doing some sort of study to develop or administer a test, student aid programs, or improve instruction. So I wanted to show you what the CMSD, Cleveland Metropolitan School District FERPA notice looks like. I'm not actually sure if they give this annually or if this is upon enrollment, but this is right on their website. And you can see here that they say, you know, you have these rights, parents and eligible students. These are students over 18 years of age, you know, according to FERPA. However, and what I've put in bold there is the legitimate educational interest exception. So they're saying, unless you opt out, there's an opt-out policy, and there are records that we don't get from CMSD because the student and family have opted out. But unless you do that, We're going to share your personally identifiable information through this exception of legitimate educational interest. I'm going to hand it over to Rob.
This is where Beth gets to take a breath. I'm the intermission. I'd like to add my thanks for you all coming out this afternoon. And I particularly want to thank Craig Zulig from the MSAS Research and Training Office and Waleed Jalabi, who's with Tech Transfer Office here at CASE. Without their partnership, a lot of what we're talking about wouldn't be feasible. Because being the investigator on a study gives you certain credibility and power, but you also need insiders who know how the system, how the IRB system works and how we need to make our requests related to this work. I did want to make a footnote to the earlier example that Beth gave around early childhood mental health services. Interestingly, that was a multi-year study, and for about 6 years, we were going along just fine, receiving those data directly from the six nonprofits that implemented the program. We had agreements with each of the nonprofits to directly submit their data to us for the evaluation of that service. And with the Adams Board becoming interested in centralizing some of their IT services, they decided they wanted to have an integrated data system within the Adams Board. So that now the data had to go to the Adams Board, and now we were forced to deal with them to negotiate a new solution to get access to those same data. So it wasn't even a new request, and the agencies that we've been working with were in support of us receiving those data. But as so many times, you know, who owns the data? You know, I think we believe the person who's represented in the data really does own the data. That's the first and most important owner. There are many data custodians along the way, but increasingly with technology advances, things that are simple like Cuyahoga County's Department of Child and Family Services has a data system, which then was centralized in the state. So now the state says we own those data, not Cuyahoga County. So that every county department has to negotiate with their state level counterpart around who actually can share data from those systems. So it has gotten more confusing, although the opportunities are great. So I wanted to talk about an example from the FERPA world, which, you know, before we became interested in looking at kind of kindergarten readiness and early grade outcomes for kids, we never really paid attention to FERPA, wasn't even on the radar. But we came to this place where we really were trying to do a more comprehensive study of looking at kindergarten readiness and early grade performance for children based on what kind of preschool experience they had. And so we knew that now we're crossing systems. We have partners who are providing pre-K services through family child care homes, center-based programs. Those kids go on to school, and we need to find the outcome from that service in another system's data. So that at the point of entry to kindergarten, they get assessed, and then we were interested in things like attendance in the early grades, chronic absenteeism, early proficiency test scores, all the way up to third grade were kind of the markers we were headed at. Well, that sounds good as a research question, sounds plausible. Now you look at the data landscape. In our county, we have 31 school districts. So every one of them has their own superintendent and school board that decides whether they're going to share their data. There is no, you might say, well, Rob, why don't you go to the Ohio Department of Education? Well, we did that. The Ohio Department of Education does not have student identifiers. They have a SSID number for every student, but they don't have names and birth dates and all those things, which we need to link those data back to our other records. So that was a non-starter. We had to go directly to the districts. So what do you do when you have 31 entities that you need to negotiate with? Well, you start somewhere, and we started with Cleveland because it was the big fish, 39,000 students in the Cleveland School District. And just to get, and if you've been here in Cleveland over the last decade or so, you know we've been through several superintendents. And we started under one superintendent, never got anywhere. second superintendent came in, and it came to the point where an advocate who was involved with Invest in Children, who lived in the same building as the superintendent, agreed to slide a letter under the superintendent's door on that hallway to get it into his radar screen. That was the level of intimacy that was required to get this thing moving. And we did. We got our first agreement with CMSD. Now, ironically, we had CMSD data, school district data, for many years. We put it into our Neo Can-Do system at the neighborhood level. But what we didn't have was all those identifiers, and we didn't have CMSD's permission to link it to other records. So that's what this new ask was. And what I've learned over these years is the default position is no, right? There's so many, all those off-ramps, there's so many off-ramps that just end in you're not getting the data. Why? Because the risks are always present. Everybody hears about a laptop stolen from a car, records stolen, hacked from various places. So that's in our mind, and that's a barrier to any new ask. So you have to be patient. You have to have a good constitution. I will tell you that getting the Cleveland data in a way that we could match took about 3 years to actually get that to move. So I felt like the king of the world. I had the Cleveland data sharing agreement, and what do? You say, okay, remaining 30 districts, you're mine. So we went to the first group of friends, something called the Inner Ring Superintendents Collaborative, which is the 16 districts that touch Cleveland. They're the closest ones, right? So we went to their group. They're already a formed group, so here's a great chance to have an audience with the right people. And we said, we want your data. And they said, well, that's interesting. We'd be happy to create a consent form, and you know, we'd ask people, and then you can get data. So that was a non-starter, because these systems don't work if you go to consenting, individual consent. The consent rates, if we could get the same consent rate that they get for the field trip to Cedar Point, yes, but for the permission to share data on your kid, unlikely that people would give that much attention. So we began that process of talking to the districts, and a key breakthrough for us was to work with something, and I didn't know anything about all these entities until we started working, the Educational Services Center of Cuyahoga County. So every county in Ohio has an Educational Service Center, and their mission is to serve the districts in their area. So we met with them. Now, they don't hold any data, but they work with every district and they provide services to them, including information technology services. So we met with them, developed a relationship, and they offered to help us create a template data sharing agreement from their attorney's office that we could then provide to member districts to make it easier on them. So they basically, the Educational Services Center giving their thumbs up, their endorsement that this can be done under FERPA law. So that was very helpful. And you know, we've worked our way along. We now have 11 of those 16 districts in the inner ring that have signed data agreements with us. We just got three more in the last 3 months. So it's painfully slow. Now, I'm confident we will get there, because the inner ring folks have, you have to think about it from their perspective. What's in it for them? What are they going to get by sharing their data, right? Just because it's allowable, as Beth said, doesn't mean it's worthwhile. So we had to promise to give them something, and something that we actually don't have funding to do. We had to promise to give them profiles of their children. So, for example, their kindergarten entrants in a given fall, we could match those to administrative records and say, what percent of your kindergartners had a confirmed lead exposure prior to kindergarten? What percent had a child abuse and neglect report? How many of their families were on public assistance? Now, this is not about Johnny Jones it's about in the aggregate. That's the limitation of the data we can provide. But it was incredibly, when they saw an example, they said, well, yeah, I could use that. That's helpful. So that's a back-end solution that we had to give them something in return. So these are $0 contracts. All right, so we'll eventually get there to all 31 districts. But the one that's going to keep me up at night is the huge number of charter schools, the many parochial schools who are kind of all off the grid. And in some of our work in the city of Cleveland, where we look at births and follow those kids forward to kindergarten, we find about 50% of the kids in some neighborhoods ending up in Cleveland schools. Where are the other 50%? Some of them are going to hit into these inner ring districts. Some are staying with other relatives attending school in other public districts, but many are in charters. And that's going to be a challenge, because if you think through what are the outcomes for kids that go to charters, or what's the selection bias issue for families that choose charters and parochial schools, you know, we run the risk of calculating, you know, the analysis of the data is going to have a key missing group. And at least the working thought is that families that are in some ways more resilient are making choices that are not their local, perhaps low quality public school. And they're more animated around getting a better future for their child. And you might then think about how those outcomes might be better, not because of the schooling, which might give us a boost, but due to the characteristics of the family and the caregiver. So imagine this data landscape, and we're trying to fill in the gaps here. We've gone a long way, and for certain studies, like in Cleveland, if we look at Cleveland kindergartners, for example, we have very good data. But as we expand to a county level, kind of community level analysis, we've got to start filling these gaps. When I came here, I didn't have any gray in my beard. Now it's really gray, so in maybe another 15 years, it'll be completely gray. And I'm going to attribute most of it to this. All right, so as I just mentioned, we're really trying to pursue population level data in the integrated space, as complete data as we can. So here's the steps that I just talked through. Started with the big fish. So part of this was just strategic. Where do you start? If we don't have Cleveland, we can't go anywhere else. But I will tell you that when we went to the other districts, the first question was, do you have Cleveland? And we said yes. And they said, well, that's nice. But that did not move them much. But they probably would have asked me to leave if I did not have Cleveland, at least. And the other thing in this saga of data access is that we've also found a partner, not just in the Educational Services Center, but in this ITC, Information Technology Center, world. So every district contracts with another vendor who handles all their IT services. They hold the data. And so if a district says, we want to do a mailing to all our students like this, the ITC will pull data from student records and provide it back to them. They'll also provide data to other vendors. If they want to do a special phone call out to families with kids in seventh grade, they will provide that data to another vendor. So for us, when we learn that, okay, here's a technological expert group who handles data, we went to them, we talked with them. They actually said, you know what? If you can get the districts to agree, we can easily do the extract. So it's almost a no burden situation for the district. They don't have to worry about having staff time eaten up. The ITC does all the work, and they were happy to do it. And the good news is that while there's 31 districts, there's only 4 ITCs. So, and one of them has the majority of districts as their in their system. So once we got a breakthrough, that became much easier. So we're still strategizing. So when I first came to CASE, and we submitted IRB protocols, sometimes they asked, do you have a data use agreement? Sometimes they didn't. It seems now every submission is, do you have a data use agreement? And you can say no, but then it's going to lead to other things. So it's almost like every case, you need to have an agreement of some in some form. And this is a legal agreement, so it does require signatures between the two entities, and not just anybody, not me, somebody who is authorized to sign on both parts. And you know, I wish that was easier to figure out who can sign. I know I can't sign, that's about all I know. But we, again, internally, we have lots of help from our technology transfer office here at Case Western Reserve. They're really the experts in these data agreements and many types of contracts. It's kind of odd that it's in this tech transfer office, but this is where the expertise developed around data use agreements. And they will carry the ball a bit once you say, okay, this entity is willing to share data at the top level, you can turn it over to attorneys and the tech transfer office, and they'll work through the minutia. Now, you can't disengage because as the investigator, you have to be intimately aware of what gets written into that agreement to make sure you can still complete the study as designed. But there, it's a huge help. And then we are, the Poverty Center is part of this National Neighborhood Indicators Partnership, which is a network of centers like ours across the country that do work like this. And so we have benefited, I wish we had benefited more from their experience. I feel like they benefit a lot from our experience. We recently submitted a paper to Public Administration Review on integrated data, and we got our feedback from reviewers. And one of the reviewers said, this is such an important example of what's possible. This is wonderful. I wish I could share your joy. But in my community, we have had zero success in negotiating these kinds of agreements. So I'm delighted that there is an example. But what they asked us to do was actually get into the weeds about how did you get the data? How long did it take from first ask to signed agreement to data extract? Which, I don't know how many of you all keep consummate records on such things, but that's something we're trying to recreate, at least to illustrate that, yeah, sometimes it takes 6 years. Sometimes it takes a couple months. And you don't know at the front end which it's going to be. So if you're going to be going down this path with the data use agreement, and I'll just say, you know, we should start with the expectation that it is a data use agreement. Sometimes you'll hear business associate agreement, BAA, which we did many of those along the way. We're now told that's not the way to go because that has special meaning in the HIPAA world, that business associate. So for us, now everything is a data use agreement. And the way I would think about this is that relationship is going to be so key because it's not going to be tech transfer or some attorney that's going to make this work. It's about why the question we're trying to answer is so crucial and why your agency is going to benefit from what's learned in this study. And you know, we've had lots of success with executive directors and directors of public entities who say, yeah, that's great. But then when we work with their folks who deal with legal or data, it's a constant foot drag. Like, well, we've never done that before. That's going to be a problem. We're going to have to talk to our regional office. We're going to have to see what we can do. And you have to stay attentive, and we've had the experience where you get the buy-in from the top and go into the weeds, and then the top changes, leadership changes. So now you don't even have that anymore. So you really have to be as expeditious as you can and make that compelling case about why do you need identifiers in order to match records to answer this question well. And that's something that you're going to have to almost have in every conversation. I will say that our discussions with Head Start in town, which have been ongoing for easily a decade, to get identifiable records, so this was going to maybe put me in my grave, still haven't successfully secured Head Start data. And I remember early on that we were in the meeting, we had talked, this was our third meeting about matching their data to other records, and one of the higher level people said, wait, are you talking about identifiable records? I'm like, yes, what do you think we've been talking about all this time? We can't do anything with aggregated data or de-identified data to answer this question. I'm pleased to report that last year we had a major breakthrough, and now we prepared jointly a submission to the regional Head Start office requesting approval for them to share data. So this is another case where Head Start says, well, it's not our data, it's the Fed's data. And so we got to go to our regional bosses. Then as Beth described nicely, you know, you have to figure out where you fit in the waiver world, both in HIPAA and in regular research consent. And then once you get all that worked out conceptually, then you do have to turn it over to the attorneys. And in the early childhood mental health example that Beth gave, I distinctly remember a phone call where we were on with the attorney from the mental health board, the Adams board, and our team, and him saying something like, I just want to talk to attorneys. I don't want to talk to you, Dr. Fischer. I want to talk to your attorney. So we had to we called the university attorney's office. We briefed her on what we needed, what the way forward was. And after that, he was happy as a clam. He agreed that, yes, this was the way to go. So I'm scared of attorneys, but you know, they can really be a huge asset. All right, now on the scientific challenges, there are many. I'm not gonna try to oversell the value of administrative data. We've all heard the term garbage in, garbage out, but increasingly that's less true. And actually, you know, on the back end, if there's garbage in there, we're way better at smelling it. And we can get rid of it at that point. So there are good things in the garbage. Even if there are problems in the underlying system. So many of our partners have really invested so much to improve their own data in order to better manage and better be more accountable to their partners. So that is paying off. But that's constantly, you know, something that we're attentive to. We're constantly, every time we match these records, we clean the source data when it comes in on a monthly or quarterly basis. We check it against our past records to make sure that, you know, there's not something strange going on. And then Nina Lalich, Sue Chen, and others conduct the probabilistic matching that is kind of the heart of the work, which is bringing in those, that new set of records and then matching against birth date, name, address, those various factors that Beth mentioned. Now, we're not interested in those factors for the most part. Once we get the match, we really only need them to make the match. The analysis involves everything else in the record set. So the tactic is to strip off those identifiers once we have created a competent match. I'll just make one last comment on data use agreements. So sometimes they're very vague and they allow you a lot of flexibility. Sometimes they're prescriptive and we'll have statements like, we have the right to review any reports that are based on this. Sometimes they try to go a little farther, and that's where the university pushes back on academic freedom, saying you cannot sign away any rights to publish findings based on the results. But what we do have to do is agree to accommodate specific types of data, and I'll just illustrate with two examples. One is vital records. We receive birth certificates with identifiers on all children born in the county. Some of those records are suppressed due to adoption actions and other legal proceedings. Those kids are missing from our system. We can't get them. So we had to accept that. Recently, in working with the juvenile court, we get those filings for every juvenile that has a case. And the court said, well, we've got these cases that get expunged. So a kid goes on, completes a program, or shows that they're not a threat anymore, we want you to remove those expunged records from the data system so that it looks like that kid never had an interaction with juvenile court. And it's either do that or give up the data. Well, we're going to do that, but it presents some logistical challenges on how to actually go back and weed out those records. I think Beth is going to say a little bit more about ethics, but you know, obviously throughout this, we're very keen on maintaining data security. In the old days when I first came here, it meant we had a dedicated server that sat on the floor, and that was the study server. Then we moved to the MSAS secure research server, which was a server in another part of the building. Then we moved to a cloud-based system at KSL, at the library, which was secure. And now we're kind of going to the last stage, which is a university-wide secure research server, which is maintained at the hospital, which has lots of protected data in it. So we've increasingly, we have tried to take advantage of the best technology protections for these kinds of data, because while we have, our aims are to learn so that we can improve social realities, we know there are bad actors out there who would love to get these same data for nefarious reasons. So it's incumbent on us to make sure that we're taking advantage of all these. I feel that I've said enough. Is this you? Let's get back to Beth.
So just two quick points on this that I want to bring to your attention. The Case Western now has this box account, which is like a file transfer server in the cloud. I guess it's highly secure. That's what they're encouraging us to use. So there's a lot of information about how to do that there, as well as the University Technology Information Security Office. They're encouraging us to create data security plans for every data set that we get. So information about those plans, they have a template. It's very user-friendly. That's all there. So again, trying to the best of our ability, stay up to date with the highest security. So that's one issue, but this notion of maintaining individual privacy with this opt-out consent framework is another one. I said earlier, I think this is what's really sort of lagging behind this integrated data movement. So in 2014, the Obama administration commissioned a working group, and they were tasked with figuring out how big data, how integrated data are changing the economy. What's it doing for the healthcare sector and other service industries? And they found great examples. Like really, if you're interested, I encourage you to read this. There's some really remarkable examples of how access to big data and integrated data has done things like reducing infant mortality by figuring out a degree change in neonatal body temperature that's been associated with mortality in the first year of life. I mean, really remarkable things. But what they've also pointed out is questions about this privacy, what do they call it, privacy notice framework, which an example would be CMSD's framework, where they just sort of say, these are your rights according to these regulations, but we want to let you know there are exemptions and we share your data unless you opt out. So there's a lot of ongoing discourse right now around this. If you're interested, I have other things that you might want to read. You know, the working group came to the realization that the amount of big data, you know, security, everything, the amount of information that's out there and the ability that we have right now to analyze it can lead to near real-time impact on lives. And there's this great discussion about digital redlining, which is the use of big data to lead to discriminatory housing and credit practices. And this is something that the federal administration is looking at. And there's a lot more, I think, to come. We've been talking a lot about the child system, so I wanted to show you the schematic and highlight from that first slide the cross-sectional and the longitudinal types of questions that we can investigate with the data in the system. So right now the child system contains about 600,000 records from kids born or living in Cuyahoga County from 1992 to the present. We have about 20 or so data use agreements with administrative entities throughout the county and state that provide records on an ongoing, sometimes annual, sometimes a quarterly basis. Rob talked a little bit about the process of how that gets integrated with different techniques to produce a longitudinal record for a child if and when they interact with one of the systems that we have in child. So with our time remaining, I would like to give you an example that's this type of data in use. I'm pretty excited about this, and I was laughing with Betsy because I looked back at the abstract I submitted, which I didn't even talk about this, and I'm like, I hope it's okay if I talk about something else, and she says, like, yeah, no one remembers, like I didn't either. I forgot what I had submitted. So this is some new research that's happening right now at our center, and I wanted to share it with you. It's very preliminary, but I think it provides a nice example of what's possible with integrated data, but there will be a lot more to come, so maybe we'll come back in a couple years. The issue is the school readiness gap. So we've long known that there's a racial gap between African-American minority students and white students in preparedness for school. There's new research that's being published like 2010 and on that's talking about the income achievement gap that's now outpacing the racial gap. So kids who are living in families below 100% of federal poverty, are about half of them are ready for kindergarten, less than half, compared to about over 75% of kids in families whose incomes are above 185% of federal poverty. So this map kind of outlines that here, a county snapshot. What we've depicted are the percent of students within districts in Cuyahoga County that are considered not on track for kindergarten according to the Kindergarten Readiness Assessment Language and Literacy subscale. And I'll tell you just a little bit more about that in a second. But what you can see is it's heavily concentrated. This lack of preparedness for kindergarten is heavily concentrated in the city of Cleveland, as well as East Cleveland, where over 70% of the children were not prepared with pre-literacy skills for kindergarten learning. And in Cuyahoga County, where we have a highly racially segregated population, you compound that with an urban core with two-thirds of kids living in poverty, it's a serious problem. So this is what we're trying to address with this research question that I'm going to talk about. We know the problem exists. We also know that there is evidence from very intense, high-quality early learning experiences that can ameliorate that problem, alleviate it to a pretty big degree. So certainly in the 70s, there were like the High Scope Perry Preschool Project and Obsidian, which were very intense preschool, high-quality experiences for low-income minority children that have demonstrated now for, you know, 20, 25 years that there are some pretty big returns, not only in academics, like graduating from high school, but also things like employment, participation in the workforce, earnings, avoiding juvenile justice or criminal justice involvement as an adult. And there is ongoing debate right now about what about large-scale, statewide universal preschool programs. So they are not as intense, though many of them are of very high quality. Can these types of programs, if delivered in a year or two before kindergarten, lead to the same positive outcomes? So some states that have a more near universal approach, like Georgia, Oklahoma, New Jersey, they've seen substantial improvements in school readiness. And then most importantly, they've seen that the biggest gains are made by kids who need it the most. So here in our county, we have what's known as the UPK program, Universal Pre-Kindergarten Program, but it's far from universal. Right now, about 2,200 kids in the county are served with the UPK program, and there's a lot more that need it. So I'm gonna get to that in a minute. But it is considered the highest quality option available for children living in Cuyahoga County. It is a competitive RFP process. So if you're already a high quality setting, and that can be a family childcare home or public preschool or a private center, you can apply to be in the UPK program. So you have to meet certain standards of quality to already be recognized as you know, is able to apply. And if you are accepted, then you get some quality enhancement dollars. So the idea would be that you can use this funding at your discretion, the site, to improve the quality. And most of that money is gone to improving, increasing teachers' salaries, right? Because the gap between a BA level kindergarten or preschool teacher at a public district is huge compared to a BA level preschool teacher at a private center. So there's a big discrepancy there. If you're a UPK provider, you also have access to some special needs technical assistance if you have children with behavioral or medical health needs in your classroom. And the big thing is there's scholarship dollars for families who are living below 400% federal poverty. So families who really need high quality childcare can get some money, somewhere between half and a third off of their tuition if they go to a UPK site. So as I said, there's nowhere near enough high quality preschool for all the kids in the county that would demand it. So that first row is the entire preschool population. These are 3, 4, and 30% of the 5-year-olds, because 70% are already in kindergarten. And we've applied a 70% estimate to that overall population. So if you look in like Oklahoma, New Jersey, those studies that have a universal program, they see about 70% of kids who are of preschool age actually do participate in their program. So we've, you know, cut it down a little bit, but you can still see total countywide, there's about 23.5 thousand kids that might, you know, would demand high quality preschool if it were available. So the thing is though, it's not. So you can see the total supply, there's sufficient supply. So there are lots of seats available for kids. But at the overall county level, only 30% of those seats are of high quality. So that's a big gap. It's a lot bigger in the county suburbs outside of Cleveland. There's much more high quality concentrated in the city. So right now in the city of Cleveland, about 6 out of 10 kids have a high quality seat. It's about 3 out of 10 in the suburbs surrounding the city of Cleveland. So the idea is, do you want to say this? He's got two slides here, so I'll just stand
here. Just to be clear that that's known high quality.
Yes.
So some facilities are not yet rated, so they're of unknown quality. Mm-hmm. We know that some that have yet to be rated are high quality. So this brings us to the current work, which is we are now engaged in a feasibility study that's been funded by the Department of Education to see whether investing in preschool, high quality preschool with a payoff in educational outcomes could be the subject of what's called pay for success or social impact bond. So this is a study to see whether the county should pursue this type of financing arrangement. And how many of you have heard of social impact bond, pay for success, a few? So it's basically the idea that you identify a population in need, a key problem, just like we've always done. We're gonna do a great service. The only difference is who puts up the money. In this environment, private investors pay upfront for the service. They give the money to the county to pay the service providers. And what the county agrees to do is pay those investors back if the program is successful. If the program does not work, the county pays zero. They do not pay for the service. If there is a social impact based on the agreement with the investors, they get paid back their investment and potentially a return on top of that. So there are some ethical concerns and debate about these type of models, but there is one in place already in Cuyahoga County focused on homeless families with children in foster care. David Crampton was provided key leadership on getting that to happen. We're in the second year of the study of that pay for success project. So there is an appetite to see whether this is worth doing. But there's also, I think, a skepticism about whether we should do things, if we know they're the right thing to do, shouldn't government do it anyway? Why do we need to involve private sector investors in this process? But the notion is that it does unleash potential new dollars that were not available, and because the outcomes pay off in the future, it allows services to happen now, and in any particular political landscape, it may be hard to get something funded now, but if you can get the money from private folks to pay for it, that may be more attractive. So I'm not going to bore you with that. We're way more. If you're interested in that, you can let us know. We have an article on this that just came out too. Thank you.
Okay, so in like the next 10 minutes, I'm going to run through the results. I feel terrible about this because this is like the staff, Laura Shu here, she's from at our Poverty Center. She's been working on this, like this is her life, and I'm just going to breeze through in 10 minutes. So so I appreciate so greatly all the work. And you know, we can talk in the next part of this more about this. So what we're doing, we have four cohorts of kids who have already been served in UPK. The program started in 2007. So you can see we have the 2007, 8, 9, and 10 cohorts of kids who enough time has passed that we can observe their outcomes all the way up to third grade. So we have kindergarten, we have data from CMSD right now all the way up to the 2014-15 school year. So as Rob said, as the data from all the inner ring districts come in, get cleaned, linked, matched, we'll be modifying this analysis to include them. We've restricted it at this point. So these are just kids who were served in Cleveland-based UPK sites and went to Cleveland schools. So it's a snapshot. With the grant, we'll obviously broaden that. We're going to be looking at the outcomes that you see here. So special education placement, grade retention, chronic absenteeism, school readiness, and the third grade reading guarantee. Before I tell you just a few things about those measures, I want to give you a little snapshot of the risk profile or the potential that these kids are bringing with them at kindergarten. So this is all four cohorts. They've been linked to our child system. These are just some of their early childhood experiences. There are a ton. I just pulled out a couple here. What we're looking at are at the birth, 24% had a teen mom. So at their birth, a quarter of the sample, their mothers were teens. You can see about 43% there, those moms at their birth had inadequate prenatal care. I can tell you how we define that. Also at birth, 43% of those mothers had not graduated from high school. So this is from the birth certificate. So we don't necessarily know what happened in the 4 years before they got to UPK entry, but this was at birth. We had a very low maternal education. 34% had any report of abuse or neglect with DCFS, 34%. 8% of those were substantiated indicated claims. But these, you know, this is a very high risk sample. 85% were receiving food assistance before their first day at UPK. And a quarter had been lead poisoned. A quarter of those kids had an elevated blood lead level. In terms of our independent variable of UPK exposure, we wanted to bring a dosage piece here. So we did break it out by high and low dose. High dose was if they had at least 9 months in a UPK setting and they went at least 16 days on average in those months. So we're trying to get a sense of dosage.
16 days per month.
We did it a little differently.
Okay.
low dose would be anything else, and then no dose, they didn't attend at all. A key here is we need to link these records to make sure that there are some kids that have had a preschool experience. It just wasn't UPK. Right now, they're in our no dose group with the kids who didn't have a preschool experience, right? So this needs to be refined a lot. The picture is still promising in what I'm going to show you, but keep that in mind, that that sample encompasses two very different groups of kids. We have the kindergarten readiness assessment, chronic absenteeism, and the third grade reading guarantee. So this is just the KRA. The mean score is on the left. So a score of 18.3, it ranges from 0 to 29. It's well in band 2, which would suggest some sort of need for remediation. But you see the pattern looks like we would expect with kids with a high dose of a high quality experience having a higher mean score, and far fewer, a quarter of them, falling within band 1, which is clearly not prepared for kindergarten, compared to about 44% of the low dose and 41% of the no dose. In terms of chronic absenteeism, I mean, take a look, the bars aren't to size, so you have to kind of look at the percentages, but this is missing at least 10% of enrollment days. That's a lot of kids who are chronically absent in all of these categories. But we see the fewest among children who received a high dose of UPK. And look at how it goes down from kindergarten to first to second to third grade. Kindergarten is a time for high chronic absenteeism as kids rely on other people to get them to school, right? So the pattern looks like we would expect here for the high dose kids, but there's still a lot of kids missing a lot of school. Grade advancement. This is on-time matriculation. So are you finishing kindergarten in a year and going on to first grade? It looks like we would expect, I think, second to third grade. It seems like the no-dose group kind of catches up. But right now we're seeing that more kids in the high-dose group, at least at kindergarten and first grade, are advancing compared to the lower and the no-dose group. Special education, I think, is interesting, and I think we have an artifact of maybe the testing here. So you actually see that more kids in the high-dose and the low-dose group come to kindergarten with a recognized special need. So that's great because there are services for them, right? So they've been identified, they'll be getting special ed services. It could also be that they've had a year experience or two maybe to be identified, right? They've been in settings where people are trained to look for the need for special ed services. So that's still something to disentangle. It's interesting, there's a pretty big jump at third grade among all groups. This also could be an effect of the third grade reading test, right? So it's not until third grade now that some kids are getting identified for needing special ed services. So there's a lot of work to still figure out with this outcome variable. The last one is the third grade reading achievement. So this was the Ohio Achievement Assessment. It's no longer given, there's a new one, but you don't really see the pattern playing out here. I will draw your attention to how few kids pass in the fall, right? In all groups, with the low dose being 13% of kids are passing that reading test. A lot more kids pass in the spring, but still we're nowhere near 100%. There's also summer school and a summer test, so we want to add that to see how many kids are passing after that summer intervention. Okay. All right, so that's it. I hope that I've conveyed that obviously all research involves concerns about maintaining privacy and requires IRB approval. Some studies using protected health information or personally identifiable information have greater risks, but it's still capable to do this work within the confines of those regulations. And we think the benefit is there. We think that the benefit really pays off. So thank you all so much for hanging with us. Any questions, thoughts, comments?
Oh, you're going to take the privilege here.
No, well, I just wanted to say, I know Craig Zolick is not here today because he's ill today. But Craig put on the intranet, so if you have a case ID, you can get on the intranet in our MSAS homepage, and that has information on the data use agreements that you're talking about and tells you exactly which university official assigns it, because you're right, it can't be just assigned by us as the right. as the investigators. Do you want to talk at all about using those forms at all?
I just want to say there's a form here, and I can, if you're interested, post it somewhere, but Tech Transfer has put this together. So it walks you through the type of information you need to include. It's all done, and you just fill it out, give it to them, and they put it in the legal language.
And usually you work with Craig on that at some point
every
time, right. I'm just remember Craig. Remember Craig in this process.
Craig,
and this will be on the Blackboard site for the PhD program.
It's maybe a little bit of a prosaic question, but how difficult was it to match all of these cases across different data sets? I've not worked with anything even remotely as complicated as this, but even in simple multiple data sets from multiple agencies, it caused a lot of heartburn.
Yeah.
A lot of heartburn.
Well, ironically, if you're just matching two data sets, you have to live with how far you can go with those two. But by having you know, I would consider our kind of our gold standard data sets, the birth certificate, a Medicaid record, child welfare services. If you have any of those and you can link together, you get a stronger match because you fill in gaps that are in the one record from another. For example, a birth certificate is going to have the address of birth. But if we're matching for a child that's now 3 or 4, that's not going to be valid. But if we have the Medicaid record, that's a monthly updated address information, and it tends to be very good. So if we can, once we match a child to Medicaid, we have high matching rates, upwards of 90%. But there are always some cases where, you know, obviously we have kids in the system that all we have for them is a birth certificate. Why? Because they never showed up in any of these systems. Maybe they moved out of the community. We don't know. But we're going to keep them in there. If we ever get another match, then we'll have them. But cases of twins at birth or where names don't get assigned by the time the birth certificate is issued, those are all headaches. Nina Lalich will tell you, you know, twins who are, you know, same sex, same birthday, same mom, everything matches up. So it all comes down to the name, and if that's, you know, names may be similar, so.
And we work with the Moms First program of Cleveland. They serve moms prenatally. That's, I think, one of the hardest ones because you might have a record in there and it's like baby so-and-so. And then mom left the program before baby so-and-so was born, and now we're trying to match that record to a birth certificate, so that's where it gets really complicated when you're working with prenatal programs.
So you have an expected due date, and you're trying to match the mom against the birth certificate with a delivery date around the due date. So it does, we've done a lot of, over the last 15 years, the system has really come a long way, but we're keen to improve efficiency now. We're integrating machine learning protocols and making some investments in the system because you always have to have some paper review where you're actually visually looking at two records that might be a match, but you're not sure. And we always do a quality sample to make sure that we're catching those. But there are so many efficiencies that can be gained by the technology now.
I mean, this is really amazing, but my question is somewhat, so after you did all kinds of thing, matching and multiple data set, multiple sources, who got the ownership of the final completed data set? Who has the ownership?
So if you read these protocols, the agreements very closely, you would see that the source agencies always own their data. So when they send us their data set, they continue to own that. But once it becomes part of the integrated data system, they do own the elements that were carried into the system. And my nightmare would be that they enact a clause in their data agreement that says that we have to return all the data. We've never had that case, return or delete all the data they provided us. We always keep their source data, you know, every time they send it to us, but once we match it into the system, it would be a major undertaking to actually have to retract that data from the various pieces. But the ownership, we believe the individuals own the data. We are the custodians. We are now creating an advisory committee for this that has all the data providers represented on it so that they can talk as a group. We convened them last spring to say, you know, they should be talking to each other and say, okay, how do we get out of our practice silos by using data to learn across those perforations between how we operate?
I want to applaud you two. I'm blown away, having done a much smaller research project at one institution and how much work was involved in that, and seeing and hearing what you've done is blowing my mind. And I applaud you for it. But I guess research is something that's very difficult to do. It really takes a passion for answering questions. But I think it takes a special individual to do the kind of research that you two are doing. I'm not even sure what my question is, but how do you, I don't know, how do you ferret that out? How do you motivate that in people in your field?
Well, I guess I would say, just from my own experience, my background, my training had nothing to do with this. So when I came to the Poverty Center, this notion of integrated data was all new to me. Now when I look back at studies that I had done at graduate school with, like, I thought it was great, I had a couple hundred people, and I was like really proud of that, which is huge. I mean, it's just, it's different here, I guess. So I never thought I would be doing any of this kind of work, and I didn't actually really even know about it as a graduate student. This wasn't something that was in my training, and nobody at my university was doing this kind of work. I think it's becoming more and more common, and I also think that there are now, like, certificates and different, you know, you can focus in your education on this notion of big data or administrative data. For example, isn't the engineering school putting something together? So I think it is becoming something that students are more aware of, and that there is some structure in place to support that before they graduate and get out into the workforce.
And make no mistake, Claudia Colton in the 1980s started really the foundational work that allowed this to even exist by doing some cross record matches in the early days. So we've come a long way, but it's a team effort. You might say we're the laziest researchers, because we don't go out into the field to collect the data, right? We're just collecting. Somebody else already collected it. But it does take a certain kind of patience to do this work. And I will just say, the thing that motivates me is when I meet with nonprofits and governmental folks, and their biggest frustration is, and most of their questions have to do with, well, we lose contact with the kids and we don't know what happens, or they get served by this other organization and we need to understand that. So their answer lies in someone else's data, and they won't share with each other, but they'll both share with us, and then we can answer the question. And I think that's a role that's unique. It could be played by a for-profit vendor, but they have a particular level of trust with the Mandel School to know that we're not, you know, we're going to protect these data to the deathbed, you know. So, did you want to add something?
No.
Okay.
Your turn.
While I've been sitting in the back row, I've been paying close attention, and particularly I'll remember when it's time for your evaluations that you're the laziest researchers. but for me now, lazy has a positive connotation. Don't you agree? Yeah, because it's amazing work that they've been doing, and very important work. So thank you very much. And I also liked the fact that your last comment was that people trust the Mandel School. So, thank you so much.